Here we have a rotating system driven by an electric motor through a transmission to a final drive. And on the electric motor, there's a resolver, which determines the angular position of the electric motor. And on the final drive, we have an encoder, which can also determine the angular position of the final drive. And what we want to do is determine the angular difference between these two positions to troubleshoot an unwanted vibration that occurs during the run-up and run-down of this rotating system. Here's some of the data. I'm going to open a multi-trace display. And what we have here is the resolver data. And if we look in on this data, we can see that this is sinusoidal data, voltage, and that is the excitation to the resolver. There is also a cosine and a sine wave that come out of the resolver. And I can plot those as well here. If I was to zoom out a little bit, you can see that the cosine and sine wave do lag each other by 90 degrees as expected. And if we zoom in enough, you can also see that really the sine and cosine wave are the same voltage, same frequency as the excitation, but the amplitude is modulated according to the rotational position in the resolver. We also have an encoder, which we'll look at here in a second, and we have the vibration data. I'm going to put this data in the input basket to do some analysis. Hit replace here. And first thing I'm going to do is calculate the rotational speed of the resolver. So I'll pick resolver to RPM here. Under function 1 and function 2, I need to enter the cosine and sine waves. So I'll put in COS here because I can use the ID if I want. Here I put in the excitation voltage, MR. Because I have the excitation voltage, this isn't meaningful, but I could put in the carrier frequency. And this is a variable reluctance resolver with four poles. I'll hit OK here, and this ID, I can call it the resolver speed. Now I'm interested in the angular position, but by calculating the resolver speed, I can first verify, because I know the RPM should be between 70 and 840 RPM or so. I can verify that the RPM is correct. And now I know that I've entered the resolver parameters correctly. I'm interested in the angle. So what I'll do is I'll also calculate the angle for the resolver using resolver to angle here. And I'll enter the same parameters as before, now that I know they're correct. But now I'll be getting the angular position. And I'm going to say I want the angle to be unwrapped, so that it continues increasing, doesn't bounce between 0 and 360, because I want to calculate the angular position across the entire time. Let's take a look. There's really no way of knowing if the angle is correct. It is increasing continuously, and that's why I wanted to calculate the RPM first with those parameters. And as expected, we have an ever-increasing angular speed. Now I want to analyze the encoder. For the encoder, I have two pieces of information. I have the speed versus time, so this is the RPM, and I also have a special trace called a raw trace, which is the moments in time or timestamps of the crossing. So this is the number of crossings on the encoder. You can see there was 83,000 crossings, and these are the times that they occurred at. If I zoom in a bit, and I change this to marker style cross, you can see if we zoom in enough exactly where those crossings occurred. when I go to analyze the encoder speed, I'm going to use a special command to take advantage of those time crossings. I'm going to use the taco moments, which uses the time stance, to recalculate the RPM. And this is to first verify that it's correct. This time, I'll just use the channel number. Looks like it's channel 16 here. So instead of the channel name, just to show that you can use either one. And that was a 1,000 pulse per rev encoder. No other special things. And this is the encoder speed. I'll hit calculate. Take a look at this. Turn off these. And yes, the RPM looks like I was expecting, goes up to about 91 RPM. So I can do the same thing, but now I will do taco moments to angle to calculate the angular displacement. Also on channel 16, 1,000 pulses per rev. And this will be the encoder angle. Calculate, and there we have an ever-increasing angular position. So I have two different increasing angular positions. If I overlay them, see that they're a bit off, and that's because there's a ratio of 9 on the final drive that I should maybe take into account before I subtract these two traces. So I'll multiply channel 20 here times the ratio of 9. And then we can subtract the difference between the two. So this one's adjusted for the ratio, and this is the angle difference. You can see if these line up on each other. They look a lot closer. And now let's look at the angular difference. Now here you can see there's some sort of drift, and that's because the ratio isn't 9. It's actually 9.04545. I'm going to recalculate. And now you see that there is no drift here. And so it's important to have the exact ratio when doing these calculations. I'm going to zoom in on one of these events here. And we can see there is something going on, kind of weird. Instead of a nice difference in the angle, we see a little glitch. Maybe some gears are becoming disengaged or hitting each other or something like that. So we have a glitch in the angular difference causing a problem. If I look at the vibration at the same time, maybe there's something going on here. Now, the vibration, it's not totally clear, but maybe if I do a filtering on channel 3, I'll do a low-pass filter. Looks pretty sharp here. So vibe, low-pass. Calculate again, and let's look at that low pass vibration. And yeah, I can see that there's a disturbance in the vibration that definitely corresponds to the glitch in the angular difference between the final drive and the electric motor. Thanks, and I hope that was helpful.